someone, just shoot the shit over the phone. And then you'd like hang up and you kind of feel like that warm, kind of fuzzy feeling. That probably doesn't happen anymore. I think if you called someone these days, you'd probably get labeled a psychopath.
You know, that's interesting to me. That's what you're listening to is an excerpt from the documentary that's airing tonight. It's premiering tonight at 10 p.m. on HBO. If you got, if you're near the TV, you might want to watch this one, especially if you're single, if you're in the dating circles. We had a writer, producer, and director Swiped hooking up in the digital age. Nancy Jo Sells is with us this morning.
Hey, Nancy.
Nancy,
hey.
Nancy. How are you, Nancy?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing well. You and I are children of the 70s.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so doing this documentary, I'm watching it. You know, I have a child who just turned 20, and I'm concerned about how she dates.
I have an 18-year-old, and I have the exact same feeling.
Yeah, and I feel like this online dating thing, I'm going to be the first to admit that I know nothing about it. I've never even been on an online dating app.
Never?
Ever.
Wow.
Not even black people, blackpeoplemeet.com. Yeah. Remember that was big and popular?
Yeah.
I've never even tried it. And according to you, 40 million Americans are currently engaged in online dating?
Yes. Maybe probably more than that. That's probably a conservative statistic.
40 million people. That's how they meet their lovers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. What do you, and these, and what's the, the demographic, like the main demographic, is it 18 to 29? Is it 29 to 34? What is it?
It's all across the board, but 18 to 25 are on the dating apps at least 10 hours a week.
10 hours
Damn.
A week?
Yeah. It's just swiping, trying to meet people, match with people, message people.
Are you on a dating app?
Not currently.
Have you used it before?
I have.
How'd it go? Did you put out the first date? I mean, what's going on? Come on, Nancy Jo Sells, what happened?
This is is this on?
Yeah, it's on. What happened?
She's like, I'm here to promote.
Here's the question: does it work the same for people who are in their 20s?
Well, I'll tell you how this documentary came about.
Okay,
which is that Graydon Carter, who's a longtime editor of Vanity Fair, now retired. He was my boss for 20 years. And I was up in his office and we were talking about what's the next thing you're going to do. And I was telling him I'd been working on this book. I wrote a book about girls, 13 to 19 year old teenage girls, and social media called American Girls, Social Media and the Secret Lives of Teenagers. So that was a couple of years ago. And I started telling him about all of this new technology. And I actually heard from Tinder from a 16 year old girl. She told me she's in Los Angeles, and she told me that she had had her heart broken, and she was just, this is 2013 actually.
Yeah.
She's just going to go on Tinder and lose her virginity. And I said, "What? What are you talking about?" I knew about Grindr because that was the gay dating app. You know, I have family members who are gay. They told me about that, but I had never heard of this. So I was telling Graydon about it, and he said, how does it work? And I said, well, look, we can look at it right now. So it just takes a second. So I took out my phone, and you know who Graydon is, right? Graydon Carter.
Yeah.
He's like,
I'm not my buddy, but
but I'm just saying, I'm just trying to get a visual because he's an, you know, he's an older dude. He's like a legend, you know, he's like, and he's a, you know, editor of Vanity Fair. So we're sitting there in his office and I take out my phone and I download Tinder and I go on it. And, you know, this is a few years ago. So I like pick a profile picture, I guess, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
You know, all these young guys, they grew up with the MILF porn.
Uh-huh.
You know?
Yeah.
So I don't think there were a lot of older ladies on the app at that point. Maybe now, I haven't been on it lately, so I don't know. So we start swiping and it's just going ding, 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 you know, just instant matches. And he said, what happens now? I said, well, we can talk to them. So he said, let's talk to them. So he took my phone actually as me and started talking with these dudes. And they are like immediately saying like, where are you right now? Like,
trying to get with you.
Wow.
Trying to get to that MILF monkey.
Yeah.
Right? That's what I'm trying to get to you.
Right.
Wow.
Right. And it's like, wow, okay, that was really quick. That happens really fast.
There's no courtship in online dating.
Right. That's what I was going to lead to. Well, first of all, it's like interesting to me that you've never even been on Black Planet's way.
I didn't even go on BlackPlanet.com. And it was big, but I didn't have to. You know what I mean? Like, I was...
But just out of, like, curiosity. But I understand what you're saying. So, would you say the main intent of these users is to secure sex versus, like, connection?
I think that, you know, from the reporting I've done and from the studies that we've seen, and you can watch the film, it's kind of a gendered response to say that there are differences in how men and women use the app. I understand that could sound very gendered, but it's actually kind of borne out by surveys and statistics and the interviews that I've done that, of course, there are women who just want to have casual sex. And there's a woman in the film who says, hey, I want casual sex and I use these apps for that and I get what I want. So we know that does happen.
Yeah.
But I think in general, men are more likely to want a hookup than women are. Uh-huh. And overall, most people do want that lasting connection eventually. And they say that they do. But I think after doing all this research that the platforms really lend themselves to hookups.
Hookups, right?
Yeah.
What percentage of people who use the platforms actually stay in long-lasting relationships?
In a survey done by Hinge, which is, this is their data, 81% of users have never found a lasting connection or a marriage.
We have Hamir on the line from Vegas, and he might be a part of that 19% that did find love. Hamir, good morning.
That's good.
Hey, what's going on, bro? What's happening with you? It's with the S, Shamir.
Okay. OQ is doing the phones right now. He's a horrible intern. he's an awesome producer, though. I mean, Shamir.
I believe it.
What's been your experience, and how long?
I got out of a relationship, and I was just like kind of took some time to be by myself, and then I was like, all right, well let me just try. I'm gonna be real. I was being kind of lazy. Let me just see if I can maybe find somebody. And then my intention was to not hook up. It was to, like, chill. And so I started instant messaging somebody, like, on Saturday morning. We went out that night, and I was surprised because I was like, look, I know girls are cautious. I know this is a dangerous thing to say, hey, let's hang out, but let's go somewhere public. Let's meet and then vibe. We met, had coffee, and we haven't left each other's side for 3 months. Now, you know, I don't know what to tell you.
3 months is not a very long time. But
the point I'm making
but
is
I wish you all the
every
best.
Day. So literally 90 days of every day I see you. And what I did, though, was I didn't have multiple people that I was DMing at the same time.
See,
I just did one person
different.
At a time. So my phone doesn't ring. You know, it wasn't a whole bunch of people hitting me up. Uh-huh. She felt comfortable because I could always answer my phone. My phone's face up with the light on. I ain't lock it. It was just, it's unique, but you're right. Most people are just, she said her experiences before me was, can I see you, can I see you, can I see you, can I smash? I didn't, you know, I wanted to get to know her, so it was a little bit different.
So how many times did you see her before you smashed, though?
You a trip, man. It was like about a week or so.
About a week.
Wow, y'all
I'm
funny.
Just teasing you. I'm happy for you guys, and if you're having a good time together, that's great. But I think you're different because what you said is so important, that you weren't looking for other people. You were giving her a chance to say, hey, do I really want to be with her? But I think what these apps and what this online dating environment really promotes is multiple partners, multiple messaging, multiple swiping, multiple platforms. You know, a lot of people are not just on one app. They're on several. Hey,
yeah, and I was on two. Like, I had, I'm sorry, just real quick, I was on Tinder and POF.
Don't do it.
I was on Tinder and POF at the same time, but like I said, I would just do one person at a time. I actually met somebody before her, but we went out and it wasn't no chemistry.
Chemistry. You know, you're a good guy, Shamir. You're a citizen, man.
That's the way to vote.
All right, we're going to come back, man. I want to hear more of your experiences. 888-742-3345. Swipe. Hooking Up in the Digital Age premieres tonight at 10 p.m. You want to talk with Nancy Jo Sells. If you've never been on done online dating, perhaps she can answer some questions for you based on her research. Give us a call. Sway in the morning. We got Joaquin on the show right now. Our special guest, Nancy Jo Sells. Writer, producer, director of Swipe, Hooking Up in the Digital Age, premiere tonight at 10 p.m. on HBO. So if you've had online dating experiences, share them with us. If you're trying to do it, maybe you can ask her a question. Is it Joaquin?
John.
Jacqueline. Yes.
Okay, how are you?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Doing well. What's been your experience with online dating?
So, about 2 years ago, I had a fiance that passed away, and I was in a really bad funk. So, thank you. My best friend told me to get on Tinder just to meet people, and my initial purpose of it was just to talk to people and, you know, kind of get myself out of a funk because I was just in the house all day, every day, and I just didn't want to deal with anybody. But I ended up meeting my now current boyfriend. We talked on Tinder for about 3 weeks, just texting back and forth. And then we eventually gave each other exchange numbers. And then after that, we went on a date a week later. And we will be celebrating 2 years coming up on Thanksgiving.
Congratulations. That's so great. It works. It worked for you, right?
Yes, it did. It worked.
Come. Okay. All right. Good.
I think that's great. It's not impossible. I think it's less likely that people who are hitting it every night are going to call into the show and say that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think that it's probably it's useful for that, for people who want that as well. And not to judge whether that's good or bad or whatever.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, there's no data to tell us exactly how much of this dating app activity leads to lasting connections and marriages. Because when I asked Tinder about it in the film, uh-huh. they said, oh, well, you know, everybody's getting married. And like, if you, everybody's, they're sending us emails. They're all getting married and getting, you know, okay, so where's your data? You're a data company. Where's your survey?
So they could be lying. So let me ask you this, because Tinder seems to be the biggest brand that I hear most about. Is that still, does it still getting the type of traffic it once did?
Yeah. It's the biggest app in the App Store right now, over Netflix, Candy Crush, Pandora, all that.
But what about like Match.com and Plenty of Fish? Are those still doing well?
Well, the Match Group, I interviewed the heads of a lot of these apps, and the Match Group is the one that owns a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
And they have, I don't know even how many, but many apps. There's hundreds, thousands in America and all over the world. It's really, this technology has really kind of overtaken the whole world of dating.
I was going to say, because with Match.com and those sites that have been around before, like the apps became popular, you really had to fill out like a long survey. I did a Match.com.
Okay.
And you had to fill out like a long, detailed, lengthy survey that took, you know, quite a while to fill out. And then they would calculate matches according to whatever your answers were. With Tinder, Bumble, and all these other apps, you literally just like put in your email and then you're registered to go and you just swipe away. So it's very, you know, it's less time consuming and all that. So I think that's why a lot of people are preferring that over the Match.com site.
They talk about the heads of the dating apps talk about that in the film. I say, why do you think that this has caught on so much? And they said they tried to make it as easy as possible.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's really just all you have to do is like log in through Facebook and you're on.
Right.
This is interesting. Nasty Joe Sells is here. Swipe Hooking Up in the Digital Age, premiering tonight at 10 p.m. Mike Muse, who's never used a dating app in his life, has a good question for you. Go ahead, Mike.
Now, Nancy, I'm just curious in terms of, did the data go further to talk about America's sexual curiosity and desires? I know you're approaching it from a situation of like hooking up and dating, but as we see an increase in Pornhub, we're starting to see more the normalization of porn becoming an everyday conversation. Did any of your data suggest in terms of the sexual desires, sexual tendencies of Americans,
well,
and how it's changing?
I thought it was really important because so many people are on these apps now to make the film very intersectional and diverse. We have people from the LGBT community that we interview, and a lot of people of color. And there was not actually one person from any one of these communities that said, "This is great. I love it. It's perfect, and I've never had a problem." You know, there were issues that everybody seemed to have coming at it from different places. And I think that that's because the platforms are the same and the platforms create a certain conformity of experience.
Okay. Jay's on the line from Massachusetts. Jay, what up?
Hey, Jay.
What's going on?
Jay, you doing great. You use a dating app?
Yeah, I use it quite a lot now, especially since I've graduated from school. Back home, a lot of friends are gone, so I'm trying to meet some new people. What I found is, I can either get a one-night stand, never see her again, or I can get these girls who say they're looking for something serious, but really it's just them wanting to text for about 3 weeks to a month and then nothing else going on afterwards.
So, damn, man, you could just get on a dating app and have sex.
Mm-hmm.
And things sure have changed. what do you think this means? Will people ever, will this ever play out, or is this our future? Will people ever go back to one-on-one, in-person communication, courtship, and that sort of thing?
I think that in the short term, they're here. And they're not going anywhere because they're making a lot of money for a lot of people. Look, one of the things that I'm trying to get people to think about through watching the film is that, again, these are businesses. They want your money. They want your time. They want your attention. They want your data. You know, when I asked the heads of Tinder, why did you make this app? They didn't say, we want people to fall in love and get married. They said, we were looking for disruption in the marketplace, which in Silicon Valley talk.
Oh, my God.
Which in Silicon Valley talk means we were looking for a way to make money.
We were looking for a lick.
Right.
That's what it means. Right. You were looking for a lick, you know, a come up.
Right, exactly.
A hustle.
So it's a hustle.
Thank you. Wow. Thank you. And those who are on it are willingly being a
That's
part
exactly
of the hustle.
That's exactly right. Yeah. And I think that, I don't really think that, you'll have to decide for yourself from watching the film, but I didn't get the feeling that they care as much whether people actually do fall in love. I think they care that you use their app. Uh-huh. I mean, it's called swipe because the swipe mechanism was designed to be addictive. And the guy who invented it talks about that really openly in the film. He basically says, I invented this to be addictive. And it is. And he seems quite proud of it. You know, so it's kind of a genius thing in a way. So when you think about it, you're doing this thing that's addictive. You could possibly get sex. And these people are making money. I hand over fist. So is this going to go anywhere? Is this going to go away? No, not in the short term. So at least. So what I'm hoping when people watch this, they'll think about, okay, so what does that mean for me? What does that mean for how we see each other? Are we really just pictures in a stack of pictures to just be swiped on? You know, is there more to us? Should we give each other more time? What's it doing to us that we're dating 24/7? Waking up in the morning, the first thing, reaching for our phone and looking at who matched with you. Yeah. And also, a lot of the women in the film, anyone who's not a heterosexual white man in the film basically had some kind of experience that they found really in some way degrading on one of these apps.
Uh-huh.
You know, we have a trans person who said that they had experienced, transphobic comments. And we have people of color, young women of color in the film who talk about, experiencing racism on these apps and people saying things that are just not acceptable. And, we had heterosexual women, white women talking about again, guys just looking at them as an easy lay.
Absolutely. That's what I see it as. If online dating, it seems to me like that's an easy way to get some sex.
But depends on how you present yourself. Because my best friend, she's going into 3 years of a serious relationship and they met on Tinder, but they were both very clear of what they wanted in their profiles.
Yeah.
It's not just a photo. You do have a little bit of space to write
something. Let me ask you this. DB, when you used to use it years ago, regardless of what was in the profile, did that make a difference in...
I could make my profile look like the greatest guy on earth, and I could be a fucking scumbag. You know what I mean? And that's kind of what some people... I don't want to make everybody to be like, that's what they're after, because there are people who genuinely put what their interests are and what they're looking for in a relationship. But then there's people who know the better you look online, the more you're going to generate interest from other people, and then you can reveal yourself once you meet them and hook up with them and then be like, all right, peace. You know what I mean? So it's almost like a catfish thing comes into play. You know what I mean? So
still risk.
Man, Nancy Jo Sells, thank you for coming through.
Thank you so much.
Writer, producer, director, Swipe. Tonight at 10 p.m. on HBO.
I'm watching.
You going to watch it?
Mm-hmm.
I've watched a lot of it. It's a really good doc. You did a great job hooking up in the digital age. You did an excellent job. Congratulations.
It's an honor to be here, Sway.
Thank you very kindly. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Up next, we're going to have the Rolling Loud founder. Rolling Loud is one of the most popular, successful music festivals there is today. Tariq Sharif is here. Sway in the morning.